I'm a pretty strong believer in the idea that a story can change you, and in some cases, can change a culture as a whole. An easy example is Star Wars. Regardless of what you think of it, it changed film forever and is still extremely prevalent, particularly in American culture. With its story, special effects, and memorable quotes, it's easy to see why it became the big deal that it still is today, in spite of everything that's happened to the franchise over the years.
Or they could just make a good movie.
I'm afraid that's not an option.
I think part of what made the first movie a success was its grand good versus evil story, and how its more simple themes were appealing to audiences at the time. From what I observed, these tend to be some of the main pillars of stories that truly become iconic and transformative. They typically touch on issues that are relatable in personal ways, and often strongly emphasize good prevailing against all odds. Which is interesting because one of Japan's biggest pop culture phenomena is somewhat of a subversion of that ideal. Evangelion as a franchise is an oddity in so many ways, and I think this is a big reason why. It fits what I mentioned earlier in the sense that it tackles very personal issues, but it's certainly not a simple good overcomes evil story. I personally would argue, at least from the perspective of the TV series, that in terms of seeing the hero overcome his struggles, our protagonist does not do that. And at best, you could call it bittersweet. Many would disagree, and I totally understand why, which is funny because this itself is an example of how polarizing Evangelion really is. I can't think of a single anime or media franchise that gets such different reactions from people, not ones that are this passionate. I'm to give some context to my experience with this show. I had first heard about Evangelion when I was about 13 years old and recently getting invested in the world of anime. However, I had never watched Neon Genesis Evangelion until 10 years later. To be honest, upon finally watching the series, my reaction was viscerally negative, and for the most part, that has not changed. However, please do not get the impression that this video is going to be a video just bashing Ava, as this is not even a review. I think that while I may. Neon Genesis Evangelion is very much a personal story of its creator, Hideki Anno. Those who are already fans know this. Anno found himself in a severe depression after working on the anime Nadia: The Secret of Blue Water. Studio Gainax, producer of the anime, was in an awkward place financially, and it didn't help Anno's situation. Due to these struggles with clinical depression, this made Evangelion become a reflection of Anno's mental state. Just going from the beginning of the series, it almost sounds like a standard mecha anime concept. Shinji, a 14-year-old boy who is forced to pilot a robot by his father and fight monsters known as angels. Yet the farther you delve into the characters, you see the true heart of the show, as well as how Anno expressed his problems. He even mentions being given a book on psychological illnesses by a friend, saying that it gave me a shock as if I finally found what I needed to say. Everyone who has watched the show knows about the more psychological and abstract nature of the second half, particularly with those infamous last two episodes where the animation budget received significant cuts and it went even harder on the abstract stuff, coining the idea known to some as a Gainax ending. With the way much of television operates today, many companies would view this as making your audience too niche and a good way to lose viewers. Yet with Ava, that couldn't be more false. On its first initial run, as the show delved more into the broken mental states of these characters, the show's viewership increased even more. I think it should be noted that the 90s, from a cultural perspective, was considered a dark place for many Japanese people. Which is why I suspect this to be one of the reasons why Evangelion became a phenomenon. This show came at a time when depression and suicide rates were at an all-time high in Japan. Japan has generally been known to have an issue with depression and suicide, however, the mid to late 90s mark a particularly difficult time. I want to mention beforehand that I am not a social scientist and that any study or statistics I mention here are from my own research, but I did my best to find reliable sources. The information that I did find, however, was consistent with each other, so I have good faith that what is mentioned here is accurate or at least as close as I could manage. Several factors have been identified as to what led to the spike in the 90s, one being an economic recession. The bubble in Japanese stock prices burst in 1990, and by mid-1992, equity prices had fallen by about 60%. Land prices began their downward spiral a year after stock prices, and while initially less precipitous than the drop in equity prices, the decline continued inexorably through the 1990s and early 2000s. Overall, this does not say good things about the economic state at the time. Another possibly bigger reason was the acknowledgement of depression as a mental illness in Japan. Depression was not something talked about outside of psychiatric circles, and a reason often cited is that it was viewed as more of a physical issue rather than a combination of physical and psychological factors. Perceptions of depression began to change with time. At this time, mental illness had gone from a hush-hush family matter to the focus of a workers' movement. Looking at the suicide rates throughout the 90s, there's a huge spike noted in the year 1997. About 70% of the overall suicides indicated were males aged 20 to 44, which makes a good chunk of the otaku fan base, something I'll get to soon. But first I want to focus on one thing. I really don't intend to make light of this, but it's insane that not only was Neon Genesis Evangelion released during this period, but also the film The End of Evangelion was literally released during the year of 1997, when the spike was at its worst. While the timing of End of Eva's release is more just a weird coincidence, I wouldn't say Eva's beginnings here are. They make perfect sense for when they were released. Eva showcased a lot about the struggles of one man, but it also said a lot about the struggles of Japanese society in general. Sure, not in every realistic way possible, but the appeal makes so much sense looking back. Hideki Anno has always considered himself an otaku. He talks about anime he likes and even makes tweets about Ultraman figurines, which is part of what makes Evangelion's take on this interesting. There are a lot of misnomers on this, and if you have already gone down the Evangelion rabbit hole, then this won't necessarily be anything new. So I'll try and make this point short. Otaku culture has faced criticism in Japanese society, particularly for its emphasis on heavy escapism. And although Hideki Anno does consider himself an otaku, he does have criticism with some of the not-so-great aspects that have crept into that subculture. He commented once, saying, "I don't see any adults here in Japan. The fact that you see salarymen reading manga and pornography on the trains and being unafraid, unashamed, or anything is something you wouldn't have seen 30 years ago. With people who grew up under a different system of government, they would have been far too embarrassed to open a book of cartoons or dirty pictures on a train. But that's what we have now in Japan. We are a country of children." Evangelion takes an anti-escapist route that many would call the meta-narrative. There's the idea of self-acceptance as we see every character in the show struggle with human connection. Focusing on Shinji, he famously says,
"I mustn't run away! I mustn't run away! I mustn't run away!"
Which is ironic as he runs away from his problems constantly. Shinji largely does not face his problems, which is a mirror of some of the critiques given to some of the Japanese otaku. That they avoid reality by absorbing themselves so much in a world that doesn't even exist. This is an issue that was talked about in the 90s and is still talked about today. A big part of Evangelion was accepting yourself and facing reality. Or, in the words of the kids today, touch grass. An anti-escapist message like this isn't necessarily 100% unique to Evangelion, but it does stand out, especially for when it came out. Which is also a bit ironic, as many of the toxic trends seen in many different anime fandoms today can be seen first in Evangelion. Just to be clear, nothing said here is meant to say all fans of Eva are toxic or do this and that. But it's interesting to see how much of the major stuff like over-analysis of the story's themes, sexualization of the characters, death threats to the creator, all that stuff that is unfortunately common in almost any fandom today, Evangelion can be seen as one of the first major ones to have a noticeable amount. We've seen examples of all of those in plenty of anime fandoms today. I want to talk briefly about one specific aspect. Everyone knows there are creeps out there who will try to make anything sexual, and even less good with characters who are minors. Evangelion has had an interesting relationship with that, to say the least, both with the fans and the franchise itself. First off, Japan has had an unfortunate history with this, only making CP illegal in 1999. Animation and drawings have continued to be in a gray area for the law, however, and this is still a controversial topic. While it might not all be labeled explicit material, several anime and manga are noticed to have sexualized underage characters, though the modern anime scene, from what I've noticed, has thankfully made this much less of a thing. Eva comes from a time where this was still somewhat more commonplace and does this with its young female pilots, specifically Asuka and Rei. Throughout the series, sexuality is a theme explored, and it makes sense why. These characters are at the age of puberty and it's important to their mental state, hence all the Freudian references that Anno uses. That dynamic is super important with Shinji, Rei, and Asuka, with all the uncomfortable tension, as well as Misato and Kaji's relationship, where Misato doesn't have any other way of making real connection, while Kaji doesn't seem to be able to commit to anything. While I will not deny whatsoever that this is important to this series, one of the issues I have is also that there are scenes that blatantly sexualize these characters in a way that seems cheap and demeaning. There are scenes where it is portrayed in a way that is more tasteful and are even integral to showcasing the mental state of the characters, while other scenes are just fan service and were not necessary. Evangelion might not be on the level of certain other titles I don't dare mention on here, but it's clearly prominent enough to be a hot topic. Even some Eva merch seem to sexualize Asuka and Rei figurines, which is frankly just gross. While there are plenty of degenerates in the fandom who seem to just argue about whether Asuka or Rei is their waifu, there is a silver lining, as I think many could see past those moments and see the more meaningful aspects in how these characters all struggled with this. It's a human aspect that everyone does face in one way or another in life, and I think it's another draw to the series. It's an uncomfortable topic, but I think a handful of anime and manga's greatest stories do tackle things that can be uncomfortable. So while I have a big problem with some of its portrayal here, and I'm not justifying it by any stretch as it's something I personally have very little patience with, this is something that is relatable to many. Another thing I should mention is that many who watched this for the first time were quite young and didn't have that mindset going in. However, looking back, it is still a problematic aspect of the series. Evangelion really was a lightning in the bottle franchise that took off more than anyone expected. Its timing and all the little elements make so much sense looking back to why people loved it. While I admit I have several criticisms of some of its writing and I didn't find it to resonate with me in a very positive way, I've seen others who very much have and have taken much good from it. Eva influenced anime so heavily that I can't help but appreciate it for that. Plenty of anime, manga, even some of my favorites, might not have been the same if it had come first. Evangelion is a strange series for sure, with a very strange history, and it will not be loved by everyone. But it is undeniably a landmark in anime history and transformed an entire industry and culture.